Welcome to the Scottsdale Heritage Connection Messenger Family Research Room at Scottsdale Civic Center Library. I'm community historian Joan Fudala. Well, I hope you agree with me that Scottsdale could be have a slogan, the city of good sports. We are so lucky to have a full range of sports activities, but I would hazard a guess to say that baseball is the crown jewel, or the diamond, if you will, pun intended, in our many sports offerings. And whether you're a spectator or playing on the field, you've got to love the traditions of baseball, whether it's the traditions, the traditional rivalries that we see in baseball, or the really big personalities of the baseball players themselves and the managers and coaches. Baseball brings so many interesting and historical facts to Scottsdale and to the greater Phoenix area. We're so fortunate to live in the midst of the Cactus League, particularly in the spring of every year. But baseball over time has really evolved into a year-round sport in Scottsdale. And now, with a look back at some of its history, I hope you'll join me for a few innings of our Scottsdale baseball history, and let's take a swing at some of the early facts. I always like to put things in context and not to really belabor the entire history of the game of baseball, but most agree that it started in the United States sometime in the mid-1800s, probably in New York with the Knickerbocker Baseball Club that started around 1845. And also colleges on the East Coast were starting to play. In fact, I found it a really interesting fact that our own founder and namesake, Winfield Scott, played baseball when he was a student at the University of Rochester in the late 1850s. So now, how did it actually come to the Arizona Territories? Well, again, we started to see some migration of playing baseball here in the late 1800s. In fact, there's a great book called Mining Towns to Major Leagues about the development of baseball here in the Arizona Territory and also in Arizona after statehood. But the first teams were probably, they were all amateur teams, and many of them were on the military posts that were started around the Arizona Territory after the Civil War. In 1909, we perhaps had the very first exhibition game. At that time, they were called barnstorming games, when the Chicago White Stockings, before they were even called the White Sox, came through Arizona Territory as they were making a sweep through several towns and cities in the West, and that took place in Phoenix. A few other barnstorming or exhibition games, but remember too that it wasn't until several years after World War II that any major league team established itself anywhere west of the Mississippi. So baseball was primarily an East Coast and Midwest and Southern game, and it took until after the war for them to start migrating teams to the West. But speaking of World War II, again, as men who were traditionally the major league players were off in uniform in World War II, women's teams became popular, as you'll recall that popular movie several years ago, A League of Our Own, featuring the women's teams during that particular era. Well, the Phoenix area certainly had its own. We had the Ramblers, we had the Maids, we had the Cantaloupe Queens, and even a future governor of Arizona, Rose Mofford, played on one of those teams. And it's a good thing she did, because later in our baseball history, her name will surface as a baseball champion again. And we had several of those ladies that were the baseball players of World War II settle in the greater Scottsdale area, and I'm speaking of the late Dot Wilkinson and Charlotte Armstrong. So then how did baseball get a foothold here? How did the Cactus League start? Well, after World War II, which had taught us some important lessons about integration, Major League Baseball realized that it was time for them to integrate their teams. And two progressive team owners thought that perhaps in integrating their teams, they might find better acceptance in the West that had no teams and no baggage, if you will. And so two teams, particularly that of the Cleveland Indians and Bill Veeck as the team owner, as well as the New York Giants, decided that they would, not only because they wanted to integrate the teams, but they also wanted to expand west, would try an experiment and see how the people living in the western United States would take to having baseball on a regular basis. And they thought that spring training was an easy experiment to try this out. So in 1947, the Cleveland Indians and the New York Giants at the time played their first games in Arizona for spring training. A couple of years later, Del Webb, known for his construction business here in the Phoenix area, happened to own the New York Yankees, and so he brought them to Arizona for one spring training season, but they then went back to the Grapefruit League in Florida. Then in 1952, the Cubs came out for spring training, and in 1954, the Baltimore Orioles came to Yuma for spring training. And with four teams now in Arizona for spring training, the New York Giants, the Cleveland Indians, the Chicago Cubs, and the Baltimore Orioles, it officially became known as the Cactus League. And as a matter of fact, that same year, 1954, there was the first of several, but the very first Cactus League World Series when the Cleveland Indians lost to, or excuse me, yes, the New York Giants, excuse me, swept the Cleveland Indians in the four games, playing again in the first Cactus League World Series. And by the way, one of the stars of the game was Willie Mays, longtime Giant and a wonderful friend to Scottsdale. Now let's talk about how baseball came to Scottsdale itself, and I'm talking about baseball in general as far as building a ballpark. Of course, in the early years, we did have some baseball here. We had the teams at Scottsdale High School. I'm told that there were amateur games played on donkeys called donkey baseball. And also from the 1920s on, we had an amateur team called the Scottsdale Blues that brought out a lot of people during the summer, and a women's comparable team called the Scottsdale Reds. But we really didn't have a major league presence yet until 1955. Scottsdale at the time was still a farming community, but in transition. We had a growing tourism community in Scottsdale. We had an arts and crafts community that was growing in the downtown area. We were adding some events to help attract tourism. So it might have been just the perfect time to maybe plant a seed about bringing baseball here. Well, the Pink Pony, which then was located at the corner of Main Street and Scottsdale Road, was the watering hole, particularly for business lunches in spring 1955 Scottsdale. And during one of those lunches, a foursome of Raleigh Feltman, Bill Wyrick, Walker McCune, and the Pink Pony owner himself, Charlie Briley, were enjoying some lunchtime conversation when in to the pony walked the general manager of the Baltimore Orioles, Paul Richards. And as the story goes, they beckoned him over to the table and they said, "Hey, Paul, why don't you bring the Orioles to Scottsdale for spring training next year?" Because it was right after the spring training season had ended and Richards was in town to play golf. So he bantered right back, "Well, you guys don't have a stadium or a ballpark, but if you build one, I'll seriously consider it." So as soon as he left, the wheels started turning, and within days, if not weeks, The group had expanded to include other businessmen like Jack Stewart of the Camelback Inn, Ray Rubicam, the famous advertising executive, Bobby Fail, the owner of the Valley Ho, some local lawyers and other businessmen, and they formed the Scottsdale Baseball Club as a group of senior executives and investors who thought that we really had a chance to build a stadium and then bring baseball to Scottsdale. So this group got busy right away. They began selling box seats to this soon to be built, hopefully, a ballpark in downtown Scottsdale. They leased land from the Civic Coordinating Council, which was kind of an umbrella nonprofit organization that had started a community center just south of the southeast of the downtown area, actually right where the Civic Center Library Garage is today. They broke ground for the stadium in June, and they had already raised the $72,000 that was required to build the stadium. Can you imagine building a ballpark for $72,000? Well, they only got part of that money through the pre-sale of the seats, and the rest of it, the actual committee members signed personal loans so that they could cover the construction costs. Wow, that's unheard of today in building a civic structure that's so important to a community. Anyway, the construction was completed in November of 1955, and the entire community of Scottsdale was welcomed to their new ballpark on Sunday, November 20th, for a Major League Baseball exhibition game. And I have to confess, since I'm a proud native of Cincinnati, Ohio, the very first home run that was hit out of our stadium was by a Cincinnati Reds player named Ted Kluszewski. So I'm very happy to report that fact. The ballpark itself was a home run, and sure to his word, Paul Richards did bring the Orioles just a few months later for spring training 1956. And so we've been off and running and have spring training here in Scottsdale ever since. Well, when the Baltimore Orioles came in late February and to start their play in March of 1956, they were giving the Scottsdale fans, especially the kids in Scottsdale, a really up-close and personal experience. With a small stadium that's barely sat 4,000 stands on bleacher seats and under beautiful sunny skies, the players and the fans could interact, they could sign baseballs and autographs, and really people felt like that was our team for the month. On opening day, the Orioles beat the Cubs. Governor Ernest McFarland threw out the first pitch. The Optimist band named Umbies Crumbies played and entertained the fan. I love that name. Scottsdale High School co-eds were the ushers. The VFW post donated flag to the stadium and raised it to fly during every home game. And Baltimore fans were introduced to Scottsdale because the game and other games were broadcast over the Mutual Radio Network. And there were a lot of great Orioles to see back then in the 1950s. We had Brooks Robinson, we had Jim Wilson, we had George Zuverink. And also on the opposing teams, the fans were able to see Ernie Banks, the famous Cub, and also Al Rosen of the Indians, who again would play an important role later on in Scottsdale Stadium history. The players stayed at the Safari in Valley Ho when they opened later that year in 1956, and they were often seen wining and dining at the Pink Pony and the Lulu Bell and other restaurants and bars in Scottsdale. I might also mention that after the Orioles left to go back to Baltimore to play the regular season that first year in 1956, the Scottsdale Blues amateur men's team hosted the Glendale Grays at the ballpark. And I mention this because we know one of those Scottsdale Grays players in that year, 1956, and that was none other than Marshall Trimble, Arizona's state historian and a longtime history instructor at both Scottsdale Community College and Coronado High School. And he fondly remembers what a big deal that was to play on a field that had just been vacated by the Baltimore Orioles. Well, after the Orioles decided, after three spring training seasons here, to go to Florida and rejoin the Grapefruit League, we were lucky enough to have the Scottsdale Baseball Club recruit the Boston Red Sox, who had been playing their games in Sarasota. And they became the spring training residents starting in March of 1959. Their manager was Pinky Higgins. They all had such colorful names. And Rudy York was the coach. But the big deal, especially the first 2 years that they were here, was Ted Williams, who was playing his last 2 years after a long run as one of the stars of Major League Baseball with the nickname of the Splendid Splinter. He then, after those last two seasons, 59 and 60, came back several years as a coach. The other big name in those early years of the Boston Red Sox being here in Scottsdale was the introduction of rookie Carl Yastrzemski, who became a household word if you were following baseball back in that time frame. And of course, we had a steady stream of baseball celebrities that came as either temporary coaches or just because they liked the aura of being around spring training. Ty Cobb came here, Dizzy Dean, and so many others. It was really a treat, no matter whether you were at a game or at one of the local restaurants, to see some of your baseball idols just walk in. Just to rub shoulders with them was really something. Well, after a really good run, 59 to 65, the Boston Red Sox decided to leave Scottsdale for spring training and return to the Grapefruit League in Winter Haven, Florida. Meanwhile, as I mentioned, that a group called the Scottsdale Baseball Club that started spring training, they were senior executives. Many of them were semi-retired or full-time retired, and they were really looking for a new group with younger men that could run baseball in Scottsdale. So at the encouragement of the Scottsdale Baseball Club members, as well as the Chamber of Commerce, the Scottsdale Charros group was formed in 1961, and they were to become the hosts of spring training. And when they were actually formed in 1961, their idea was to be really the boosters of sports of all kinds in Scottsdale, and they supported golf tournaments and polo matches and other sports, but their main bread and butter was spring training here in Scottsdale. And by 1964, they were not only hosting a beloved event to kick off spring training every year, and that was an old-timers brunch or lunch, but also they, by December of 1964, had a three-way deal with between the Civic Coordinating Council, the City of Scottsdale, and the Charros, where the Civic Coordinating Council leased the stadium and the land to the city with the understanding that the Scottsdale Charros would then take over the running of spring training. And this was really a hands-on effort. I mean, sometimes the Charros were out actually painting the bleachers and the fence, as well as during the game selling the programs, selling the tickets, handling the advertising, and you name it, they took care of it. But they were off and running and certainly have been a mainstay of spring training ever since their formation in 1961. And what's really fabulous is not only do they ensure spring training thrives and survives in Scottsdale, but they return thousands and thousands of dollars a year in baseball proceeds back to the community in the form of grants. Well, spring training baseball wasn't the only game in town, sorry for the pun, but also there was some really great baseball being played at our local high schools. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that in the early 1960s, we got to see a future baseball Hall of Famer in action as a member of the Scottsdale High School Beavers baseball team. And that is none other than Jim Palmer himself. His family had moved here in 1960, and he spent his high school years until he graduated in 1963, not just playing baseball, but he actually lettered in all three sports of baseball, basketball, and football, and had had in mind that he wanted to play college basketball when he left Scottsdale High. But after graduation, he was drafted by the Orioles, and 2 years later, when they were, of course, doing their spring training in Florida by that time. 2 years later, he's a major league pitcher. 2 years after that, he's actually pitching in a World Series. And over his whole career with the Baltimore Orioles, he had a career run of 268 Major League Baseball wins. He earned three Cy Young Awards, and he was inducted into baseball's Hall of Fame in 1990, and all started here in Scottsdale. And oh, by the way, after he retired from baseball, some of us might remember that he was a pitchman for underwear, of all things. So back to spring training. Unfortunately, after the Red Sox called it a day after their spring training in 1965, we had one dark season, and there was no Major League Baseball spring training held at the Scottsdale ballpark. But we did have a team here over their college spring break when the University of Michigan Wolverine team came. And oh, since I'm an Ohio State graduate, that's hard for me to say the Wolverines, because oftentimes we Ohio State Buckeyes don't mention that team up north in its name. Anyway, during that time, there was actually a real dark season for the entire Cactus League. It was down to only two teams, and it was only the San Francisco Giants. The New York Giants had since moved to San Francisco and were still holding their spring training in the Phoenix Municipal Stadium. And the Cleveland Indians, those are the only two teams that were left here in Arizona. So the Charros, now that they were hosting baseball, spent much of their year scouting for a new prospect. And weren't we thrilled then when we secured the Chicago Cubs to move here and relocate their spring training to the Scottsdale ballpark? They came for the 1967 season, and with them brought great players like Ernie Banks, Ron Santo, Billy Williams, Fergie Jenkins, and many other stars that became household baseball names. And oh gosh, you have to love the Cubs. And believe it or not, we were thrilled to have the Cubs here, even though in their 1966 season they finished in last place. But you know those Cubs fans, they are absolutely loyal. Loyal to a fault, and thank goodness they are, because we all love Cubs. Anyway, in that first season of 1967, we were thrilled to have not only the players, but the colorful manager at the time was Leo Durocher. In fact, he was so colorful that the Scottsdale JCs renamed the bull that was featured in the Parada del Sol rodeo Leo the Lip, after Leo Durocher. So he was a beloved character when he was in town for spring training. That's Leo Durocher, not the bull. And he was also a speaker at the kickoff luncheons that the Charros had, and was a popular figure around town. Another celebrity that came here during that first season was then Governor of California, Ronald Reagan, whose wife Nancy's parents lived in the area. And they were frequent visitors, but this was a chance for him to see the Cubs that he had so enjoyed when he was growing up in the Midwest. And the other interesting thing that happened in 1967 that started another spring training tradition here was that the auxiliary members of the Scottsdale Baptist Hospital, which was located right across the street from Scottsdale Ballpark, began parking cars for a minor donation. I'm talking like 50 cents a car. And over the years, they became familiar figures at the Scottsdale Ballpark. as the hospital changed names from Scottsdale Baptist to Scottsdale Memorial to Scottsdale Healthcare, and now to, of course, Honor Health. But they've continued to volunteer in many ways, oftentimes as ushers, no longer parking cars. But that's been a longtime partnership with spring training. Now, I just want to give you a great story that Paul Messenger had shared with me several years ago about how low-tech baseball was during the time of the Cubs in the late 1960s and throughout the 1970s in the old wooden ballpark. The Charros had a trailer that they moved onto the stadium property during spring training, and that was their official office. And during those days, the ticket price to get into a spring training game was only a few dollars, and everybody paid in cash because, again, this was before people used credit cards and there were no ATM machines. And so one of the jobs of the Charro's treasurer, still called the Ladrone, was he had to count the gate proceeds. And by the fourth inning, he had to pay the Cubs their share of the day's take at the gate in order for the game to proceed. Can you imagine that if they weren't paid, the game would be called off? So the Ladrone, or the Charro's treasurer, would be in the trailer counting the cash, and the team secretary would be waiting there, probably with his arms crossed, waiting for the cash to be counted, and then he would be given their percentage of the proceeds. The team secretary would then open the door of the trailer, look up at the stadium open-air press box, where another member of the team would be waiting and looking down, waiting for the thumbs up, so that the team secretary would say, okay, we've been paid, and then the guy up in the press box would walk to the field side and give a thumbs up to Leo DeRocher down on the field, and then the game could proceed. I just love that story because I just can't even imagine back in the low-tech days before ATMs and pre-sale of tickets on credit cards and whatnot, that was the system to let the games continue. So proceeding now through the next era of our spring training history, the Cubs decided that they were getting a little bit tired of the run-down condition of Scottsdale's old wooden ballpark. And so the Mesa offered them a little bit more of an upgraded ballpark, and they decided after the 1978 season to move to Mesa. Well, never fear, Charlie Finley, who owned the Oakland A's, decided that he would bring his team here, but only promised a short-term run. And so he brought the Oakland A's to Scottsdale to play their spring training games for the 1979, 1980, and 1981 season, again hosted by the Scottsdale Charros. And fortunately, because Finley had said this was only going to be on a short-term basis, the San Francisco Giants decided that they really wanted to be located in Scottsdale. It would be just a perfect location with the downtown siting of the baseball stadium, and by the early 1980s, surrounded by a thriving community with restaurants and shops and resorts and hotels, that they were going to be here. So we didn't have to go scouting during the time that we were enjoying the athletics being played here. And the athletics were also enjoying the new Indian School Park practice facilities that the city had built and opened in 1978, which was a big upgrade from what they had been using at El Dorado Park. So here come the Giants for their first season in 1982. And by the way, sometimes I see some confusion on when during the 80s they actually came here, but it was 1982, which means, as I'm giving this, in March of 2021, they are playing now their 40th season in Scottsdale. So we are so blessed to have the Giants as our long-term friends here in Scottsdale for spring training. They decided to come here and brought with them a wonderful group of players that we've so enjoyed. Certainly two names jumped to the forefront in those 80s and 90s games in the form of Matt Williams and Barry Bonds, just to single out two. And what's interesting is during the late 1980s, the general manager of the Giants was Al Rosen, who back in 1956 had played as a Cleveland Indian the very first year that we had the ballpark. So he knew only too well how old and kind of dilapidated that old park was. So he undertook a major lobbying effort with Mayor Drinkwater and the Charros to build a new stadium so that they would continue to be happy and continue their run in Scottsdale. And in fact, the entire Cactus League was again in kind of a bad situation in the early and late 1980s. Because Florida was aggressively poaching spring training teams and bringing them to the Grapefruit League by subsidizing a lot of rebuilding or building new stadiums for the teams. So Governor Rose Mofford, who had been on one of those women's teams during World War II and was now the governor of Arizona, along with Joe Garagiola and many sports leaders from around the greater Phoenix area, certainly with big participation from Scottsdale baseball leaders, tried to beef up not only the Cactus League, but also Scottsdale. So Mayor Drinkwater formed the Mayor's Baseball Committee, which produced a report, which is here at the library and makes quite interesting reading. And they, had a lot of Charros involved, as well as others who were familiar with the sports scene in Scottsdale. And Charlie Smith, a former councilman, certainly became one of the champions, along with Art Deckebuter, Jim Bruner, and others who were longtime Charros and knew the impact that that baseball had in Scottsdale. So in 1989, a building of a brand new stadium was included as part of a big bond package that, fortunately, with a lot of outreach, the citizens overwhelmingly supported. And on a bigger picture, Arizona decided to impose a rental car tax so that the proceeds of that could go toward enhancing and beefing up the entire Cactus League with better and better stadiums and newer stadiums so that it would eventually grow to the current size of 15 teams. So the last game in the old wooden stadium was held April 3rd, 1991, against the Brewers. And as soon as the game was over, they auctioned off a bunch of the memorabilia for charity. And then came the bulldozers and the wrecking balls, and they completely flattened it. This was not a redo. This was a complete gut job, as they say in some of the rehab shows these days. And once the old stadium was gone, Mayor Drinkwater hosted a grand groundbreaking ceremony in June of 1991, gleefully attended by the San Francisco Giants, the Charros, and members of the City Council. And with a diligent construction crew, it was ready for play by the end of February of 1992. And in we came to the brand new, wonderful, multi-purpose stadium, which was going to be able to accommodate not just the San Francisco Giants and became the envy of all of the other spring training fields around the valley, but it was also going to accommodate a lot of other functions in Scottsdale. And in 1992, for many years, we had wonderful baseball, and then the stadium had another set of upgrades in 2006, adding an adjacent practice field and also the Charro Lodge. But during those years, and more recently, the Giants have treated us to going to three World Series, 2010, 2012, 2014, which has really given a thrill to local Giants fans. And I'd also be remiss by saying there was a fourth World Series appearance since they've been here at Scottsdale Stadium. That was the year of the San Francisco earthquake in 1989, at which several Scottsdale residents had attended and got all shook up during one of those games. Anyway, the Giants have continued to be wonderful to our community as well as giving us great baseball. They've been charitable. They in recent years have held a marathon as part of spring training called the Giant Race, which benefits local and San Francisco charities. And for all of the impact that they've given us in Scottsdale, they were inducted into Scottsdale's History Hall of Fame in 2018. So as I mentioned, the new stadium was in Scottsdale, opened in 1992, and was meant to really prolong Scottsdale's baseball year. And so the AAA team that was affiliated with the San Francisco Giants, known as the Phoenix Firebirds, moved from Phoenix Municipal Stadium to Scottsdale Stadium. It started their games in April of 1992, playing throughout the summer, and gave families and Scottsdale and baseball fans a nice outing during the summer. And the beloved Firebirds mascot was a familiar sight at many community events during the time that the Firebirds were here. When the Diamondbacks announced that they were going to have their first season in, as a major league expansion team, there was an MLB rule saying that you couldn't have a AAA team and a major league team in the same metropolitan area. So the Firebirds vacated Scottsdale Stadium and moved to Fresno, California. But they gave us a lot of entertainment in the years that they were here. Then furthering the baseball season, and continuing today, the Arizona Fall League of Major League Baseball started a team here in 1993 with the advent of the Scottsdale Scorpions. And the idea behind the Arizona Fall League, of course, is to take the best prospects from the minor league teams and bring them to the Arizona Fall League, have them play against each other, while scouts comprise a lot of the spectators in the stadium. And then those players are often moved up to the major league teams. And boy, have we seen some superstars here long before we knew they were going to be superstars. One kind of an anomaly happened here in 1995 when baseball great Michael Jordan decided that he wanted to try his hand at playing baseball and played for the Birmingham Barons minor league team. And the Barons sent him to Scottsdale to play one season with the Scottsdale Scorpions. But we've had fall leaguers play here in Scottsdale Stadium that have included big names now like Michael Piazza, Derek Jeter, Albert Pujols, and so many others. So these games are seeing perhaps future Hall of Famers in the making right here in Scottsdale Stadium. So beyond Scottsdale, but with a huge influence from Scottsdale, we also benefited from the fact that Phoenix finally got a major league team in the form of the Arizona Diamondbacks in the late 1990s. After years of lobbying Major League Baseball, with two big champions rising to the top as far as names associated with Jerry Colangelo, who was Mr. Sports and owned the Phoenix Suns at the time, became the owner of what would be the first Diamondbacks team, and also a Scottsdale figure also became a very important champion of baseball, and that was Jim Bruner, who was a former city councilman here in Scottsdale, a longtime member of the Charros, and a baseball fan. But at the time, he was on the board of the Maricopa County Board of Supervisors, and they had took the bold move to find a funding mechanism in the form of a very short-term tax that paid for the building of Bank One Ballpark. And it was instantly successful when the Diamondbacks played their first season in 1998. Since, of course, it's been renamed Chase Field, but within 3 years of playing, the Diamondbacks became world champions when they beat the New York Yankees in the World Series. And of course, throughout those years since they've been here in 1998, many of the Diamondbacks live in Scottsdale and of course play on our border during their spring training games. And they've been really good to the community and the Diamondbacks charities benefiting many of our local organizations here in Scottsdale. So we love the Diamondbacks. And as I mentioned, as of 2011, we've seen even more of the Diamondbacks because as the Salt River Fields had its debut season as a spring training facility right on our border with the Salt River Pima Maricopa Indian community, we see the Diamondbacks and the Rockies play there during March. And I might mention that with the opening of Salt River Fields, it became, and still is, the only Major League Baseball facility located on Native American land in the entire country. So that's really a feather in the cap for our neighbors, the Salt River Pima Maricopa Indian community. Not only do the Diamondbacks and Rockies play their spring training there, but they use that as a year-round practice facility, rehab facility, test out rookies there, etc. So that has become a huge asset to Scottsdale for tourism and for local recreation. And also, during the off-season, many events are held both at Scottsdale Stadium and at Salt River Field. But baseball has always been all about the community, and thanks to the Charros and all of that they give back to the community by hosting baseball, they hold, during spring training, youth clinics that are a real incentive for kids to do well in school and come out and meet the baseball players during spring training. But also the Charros have given wonderful grants for scholarships to students and teachers throughout the school district here. They give tech grants to the Scottsdale schools. They support local sports facilities for youth. And they give grants to many nonprofits, including the Friends of the Library, who help fund projects here at the Civic Center and other libraries, to the Historical Society, and to many other organizations, most specifically to the Scottsdale Museum of the West. So baseball has turned out to be so beneficial to Scottsdale, thanks to the also generosity of the Scottsdale Charros. It's been a huge economic impact generator for tax revenue, as well as business for local restaurants and hotels and retail shops throughout downtown Scottsdale. And they've also, because we've become known as such a good place for Scottsdale, for baseball, Scottsdale has become a favorite place for other baseball events to take place. Those old-timers luncheons have morphed into other baseball activities, like the Senior Softball World Series has often been held here. We've had Scottsdale Community College host junior college athletic events here for baseball. In 2006, the first round of the World Series, a World Baseball Classic, was held here, and on and on. So this, again, has become Baseball Central USA right here in Scottsdale. But it's not all just about professional baseball. We've grown our own here, just like I mentioned, Jim Palmer. But we've also created a lot of recreational opportunities, whether it's been in, I'll show some great photos here of in the 1970s and early 80s, the city had a team that even included Mayor Jenkins at the time and a council member, Charlie Smith, as well as senior staff members from the city. They had a team. And of course, Scottsdale High School has had men's and women's baseball teams that have excelled, as well as the other high schools in Scottsdale, Coronado, Arcadia, Desert Mountain, Chaparral, and Saguaro Highs have all had great teams, and more recently Notre Dame Prep. In fact, one of their graduates, Aaron Slegger's team, he's now with a The Tampa Bay Rays played in the Super Bowl, right? That was in Tampa this year too. They played in the World Series this year with the Tampa Bay Rays. And of course, we've run the gamut of age groups of baseball. We've had Little League and T-ball all the way up to senior softball leagues throughout Scottsdale. And we've enjoyed the baseball played at ASU that have featured alumni such as Barry Bonds and Bob Monday, who played for the Sun Devils back in their own day. And you never know what's on deck for Scottsdale now and into the future. Who knew that in 2020 that we would be just settling back for a standing room only crowd in the first week or two of baseball and enjoying the renovations that have been done over the preseason, giving the Giants a new headquarters and office building right there adjacent to the stadium, but also opening up a wonderful event facility there at the stadium. But then, boom, in the middle of spring training last year, COVID hit, and they had to cancel the rest of spring training, which of course impacted not only baseball itself, but tourism and all of the restaurants and retail operations in downtown Scottsdale. Another thing that's happening this year is the fact that after the Giants have been using Indian School Park for many years as an auxiliary training facility to the stadium, they've now been looking at a new facility that they'll use as an auxiliary stadium in Papago Park. So we'll stay tuned for that. But remember, they're still going to play their spring training games right here at Scottsdale Stadium. And now that it's March 2021, we're having a COVID full season. Despite the COVID protocols, we're playing every game, we hope, and we're now getting used to wearing masks and having a little less attendance at our baseball games, but the spring training games will go on. So I hope you will agree, after playing these many innings of Scottsdale baseball history, that whether it's the 1955 rustic ballpark that was on the same site as it is today, but surrounded by cotton fields and other farm fields, to today's baseball field, Scottsdale Stadium, that's surrounded by a vibrant downtown community with an across the street neighbor of one of our major healthcare campuses, that baseball has been just a wonderful, wonderful addition to Scottsdale's economy and has had a major impact on our history for well over 60 years. So I hope that this has spurred you on to go enjoy baseball, whether it's a baseball spring training, baseball Diamondbacks, or your own family's Little League or Senior Series events. With that note, go enjoy some baseball. Thank you.